Hallelujah. Let's give the Lord a clap of praise tonight. Oh, we worship you, Lord Jesus. We magnify your name. You're worthy to be praised. Hallelujah. Amen. Well, why don't you greet two or three people and tell them you're looking good. Amen. I see Jesus in you. Amen. Tell them you're looking good. I'm so glad to be here in Maryland with Bishop Fondon. Is it Fondon? Fondon, yeah, amen. And Bishop Mwaka and Bishop Buffer. Praise God. I'm going to get it all right. Hallelujah. And I'm blessed to have been brought up in Africa, but I lived in America for a long time. My parents were missionaries, so I lived all over the world. In fact, my mom was born in Zambia, in Kitwe. Hallelujah. Oh, really? Oh, that's amazing. Hallelujah. She was born in Kitwe. Glory to God. Well, I give the Lord a praise. Amen. And so, hallelujah. In fact, my wife's father was also born in Zambia. And it just so happened that way. So, isn't it amazing? God is good. And I'm glad that I could be here today. You know, the Lord just told me many years ago, because I used to travel around the world, He said, you need to die to your ministry. And I was sitting on the stage with Benny Hinn, and I remember my spiritual father said to me, he said, you need to die to your ministry. God says, are you willing to die to your ministry? So many years ago, 9 years ago, I put it all down. And the Lord just said, get, just die to it. So I died to it. And I went to Cape Town and started a church there. And hallelujah, God did a lot of different things. Amen. Amen. But I believe this is a moment where God is about to release some things. And praise God for being obedient, Bishop Fondon. Amen. Amen. Now, I know I've got a certain amount of time because we want to be honorable to our brother, our man of God from Zambia. And we both come from the southern hemisphere. Isn't that good? Hallelujah. I tell you, I was sitting there and thinking, thank you, Lord. You know, Africa has got something in it. Amen. Amen. And my spiritual father, he was anointed by an African man. In fact, this African man, Brother Andrew Dlamini, he was a mighty prophet of God, Andrew Dlamini, and he prophesied over him before he was born. And God called him to be an apostle. He was a mighty apostle in Africa. And I got to be under him. Hallelujah. He raised many people from the dead. God sent me back to Africa from America to be under him. Hallelujah. And he taught me many things. Hallelujah. But I want to get in the Bible today. And I'm going to just go very quickly. Psalm 104 said, the winds are your messengers, flames of fire are your servants. The thing the Lord said to me is that we're all talking about prayer, but there's a realm of prayer that God wants us to move into, and it's the Holy Ghost power prayer. Meaning that there's a realm of the Spirit that God is calling the church to enter into, is that we're literally like the wind. The wind blows. The wind moves. The wind is not controlled by, it just moves. The wind moves. The Holy Spirit is like the four living creatures. The four living creatures move forward, they move back, they move left, they move right, and in it is fire. And God said to me is that there's a realm of the Spirit that is going to begin to take over to drive out the works of the darkness that are wanting to come over. And I believe there's a reason that God has sent many people from Africa into America, because America is losing the fire. And they're getting into a lot of strange fire. And thank God people that come from Africa understand what strange fire is. And I'm telling you, there's a move of strange fire in the prophets in this nation right now. And God is about to bring an adjustment. Hallelujah. Amen. So the Bible said, I want to just go into 1 Kings chapter 18. After many days, the word of the Lord came to Elijah in the third year. And he said, go show yourself to Ahab and I will send him rain on the earth. Somebody say there's a correction about to take place. The Lord spoke to me about correction. The word of God said in Hebrews, God chastises those whom he loves. You know, many people don't want God to give them any discipline. I thank God for discipline. You know, I had a father who was in the ministry and I saw many miracles. We drove without gas in the car for 9 hours. I saw money appear in my dad's lap. I saw food multiply. Praise God. I went to countries with my dad where we never even had passports or diplomatic ties, and I saw the power of God. But then the Lord sent me under another man of God, an apostle, for 12 years, and I saw many miracles, and the Lord spoke to me something, and he said that there's a realm that we got to move into, and that is the Elijah anointing. And when I say the Elijah anointing, I'm not just talking about a man with hair all over the place and he's living out in the desert, but the Bible said, he said in the word, he said, if the spirit of Elijah does not come, he said, the earth is going to have a curse on it. And there's a curse that is on the earth now, because the church, and I'm talking about not just here, but I'm talking about in the world right now, is allowing a lot of strange spirits and strange fire and strange doctrine, and there's a situation taking place. Amen.
Amen.
And so the Bible said that there was a correction, a discipline. I thank God I got to sit under men of God and to serve men of God, and they would bring correction to me. They would bring discipline to me. And many times they would sit and tell me every sin I ever committed. Hallelujah. They would have services where they would just sit and tell you what you were thinking. And I would say, oh Lord Jesus, here we go again. Hallelujah. But they would tell you every sin you ever committed, every thought you ever thought. You didn't even know you had it, but praise God for correction. Now today we got a lot of things happening where they are bringing the gospel down. And they're bringing the gospel down, and they're bringing it down to no correction, no discipline. And you've got spiritual adultery. We have a problem because people don't know what it is to be a child of God anymore. And I thank God for Pastor Fondon and Bishop Nwaka and those that are here today that have got an assignment from the Spirit of the Lord. Anyway, I need to be sensitive to the time. After many days, God said there's a problem in the land and it's a famine. And the Bible said in Amos, it said there's a problem in the land. And that problem in the land is that there's a famine in the land. He said it's not a famine. It's not a famine of food. It's not a famine of thirst for water. But it's a famine of people hearing the words of the Lord. I believe the famine in the land is people don't know how to hear God's word anymore. They are spiritually deaf. They are spiritually desensitized. There's a lack of sensitivity. They are not in the spirit. They are in the animal nature. They are in the carnal nature. They are in the beastly nature. And you have a lot of preachers that are beasts. And you have a lot of congregants that are beasts, and they shouting hallelujah and they saying amen, but they living in the beastly nature. Come on, somebody. There's a lot of people living in the beastly nature. Now Elijah came because he had to bring a correction, and people are reacting this generation to correction because they have a rebellious spirit. We have a problem in the world today, and it's unlocking a strange spirit that is going to bring persecution if we don't bring a correction. Come on, somebody. If the spirit that comes, the Bible said, if the spirit of Elijah comes, which is a spirit of burning, will begin to burn, come on, it will begin to burn in you, it will begin to burn everything in you. And I had a vision. The Lord began to show me people that were going into fires. Amen. But they were afraid of fires, and the Lord said this to me. He said they must not be afraid of the fires, and when they went into the fires they started laughing. You know what God said? And God began to burn. Hallelujah. Many are afraid today of the tribulation and the trial by fire. What did he say? John the Baptist said, he said, the one that is coming is going to baptize you in the Holy Ghost and with fire. Now there's a realm of fire that God's going to begin to take control in, and he's going to begin to burn. All right. There was a correction that began to take place because there is a famine. The famine is of hearing, but I also believe that it's also the inability to hear because many people are in the realm of knowledge. You know, you've gotten the Bible in the book of Revelation. The book of Revelation begins to declare in Revelation chapter 12 about a dragon. And this dragon is in the heavenlies. And this dragon is the accuser of the brethren. The Bible said overcame by the blood of the Lamb. But there's something that this dragon wants to do. It wants to spit out a lot of water. Right now we've got a dragon in the heavenlies. We've got a lot of people preaching from the dragon. You got a lot of new age power preaching from the dragon, and it goes like this. It's blowing water. It's flooding people's minds, people's souls with information. There's a lot of information that is out there. There's a lot of water that is over the earth, but it's not God's water. You know, the Bible said that he separated the waters from the waters. There's a water spirit, but it's not the Holy Spirit. Water, pure water, it's another kind of water. Come on, you know from Africa, there's water. And that water's another kind of water. It's the beastly water, but it's a knowledge that's another kind of knowledge. And people are being bombarded with that knowledge, and they don't know what to do with it. And it's going for the church. The correction is going to come with what the Bible said in John, in Matthew chapter 3. John speaks about how he prepared. God said in Matthew chapter 3, the spirit of and the power of Elijah is John. John is representative of the Holy Ghost. Amen. Yes. John means the gift of God. We need the gift of God, hallelujah, back in the church. We need it back in the body. We need it back in the pulpits. I tell you, I've got a places right now. People don't even know how to pray in the Holy Ghost anymore. Thank God we got some folks from Africa coming on the inside of the United States of America, and they're here to stir up some flames, amen. And I tell you, never lose that flame. Don't get caught up in money. Don't get caught up in all this stuff. You've got an assignment, and it's to move in the power of the Holy Ghost. Now John the Baptist came and he said, I'm the gift of God. I'm coming as the gift of God. God is going to anoint some folks with gifts and anointings to blaze a trail, to prepare the way for the image. Now the big problem we have today is we have false images. What Elijah had to confront was the spirit of idolatry, which is imagination. Hallelujah. Imagination. Jezebel and her prophets. What is Ahab? Ahab is a spirit. Ahab is a spirit. It means selfish love. It's, in fact, it's self-preservation. Jesus said, if you want to come after me, you must deny yourself and you must take up your cross and you must then follow me. And he said, you cannot look behind. You've got to follow me. The spirit of self-preservation. Self-preservation is about self. It's about all about self. And so we got books like I Am and Better You and Better This. I tell you something. All Jesus said is you must die. And if you die like a grain of wheat and you fall into the ground and you die, if you're willing to die, if you're willing to die to your vision, if you're willing to die to your dream, if you're willing to serve the man of God, if you're willing to serve the kingdom, if you're willing to put it all down and put your hand to the plow and never look back. Hallelujah. There he began to speak. The spirit of self-preservation empowers the spirit of Jezebel. And the spirit of Jezebel literally means unhusbanded, meaning that you are not bound to the word of God. You are not, you are an adulterer. Self-preservation will produce the spirit of, let me rephrase it, self-preservation will unlock the door to spiritual adultery. When Moses and Aaron, and they were there, and there were those priests, and they went out and they took a censer and they took out strange fire. There are a lot of folks right now that are out there on their own agenda and their own assignment, when the Spirit of God did not say, I'm separating them. He said, I separate Paul and Barnabas to the work of the ministry. Amen. Many are not separated, but they are tired of waiting. And so they are moving in a false anointing. And most people don't even know the difference because the fire looks the same. Let me tell you something. You can have an anointing to heal the sick, raise the dead, cleanse the lepers. And the Bible said, I don't know you. Because God doesn't know you if you do it out of yourself. When you take it out of self, you commit adultery with God. Because you are then committing fornication with the spiritual dark powers without you even knowing it. Because of the spirit of rebellion, you get under Lucifer, and then he puts his seed in you. Come on, somebody. Satan then puts his knowledge in you, his seed in you. It becomes a strange fire because you get out of authority. You're either under authority and God sends you out, or you send yourself out, but you still get under another authority. And the dangers, many people think, well, I raise the dead, I cleanse the leper, I heal the sick, hallelujah. But the Bible said in Romans chapter 7 and 8, he said, you I don't know, because you did it out of your own nature. Come on, there's the spirit, there's the flesh. And he said, you have no part of me. A lot of people have no part of God because they're not in his nature. God will process the church. This is where we're taking through the Holy Ghost and fire to prepare us to be filled with his nature and then his power. Come on, somebody. So the spirit of Jezebel is adultery, but it is spiritual adultery, but it is also strange fire. Now let me tell you what strange means in the Hebrew. It means adultery. You're not committed. You're not bound to the word. You try and use the word to your own advantage. You are not submitting to the word. You're using the word. Come on, somebody. Satan uses the word. Your throne is not connected to his throne. Jezebel then went, and I'm going to say this, there's a spirit that has cut off the voice of the prophets. And we're here today, glory to God, because I believe God is bringing new prophets and the apostolic. I believe it's the apostolic to birth, the prophetic to declare, to bring forth into this nation and the nations of the world, to push back the planes of darkness, to expose the works of the enemy. But until we deal with that principality and that power, which is self-preservation and spiritual adultery, where people do not value the word of God, we will sit consistently with this problem where the walls get broken down, because the false prophets are prophesying to what people want to hear. The word of God said that he gave them over to the lie because they love the lie. A lot of people love the lie. A lot of people want the lies. They love lies. But then the funny thing is they love the lying preachers, because the lying preachers feed their flesh. And all we have is a lot of flesh being fed and people's egos being built up. But I tell you something. I don't want to feed anybody's ego. In our church, I tell you something, we don't go and sit now, well done, well done. I mean, we cannot play around. If people are in the kingdom, you're in the kingdom. And God will promote you. God will promote you. God sees what you do. You don't need man to give you a little pat on the back. Oh, no. There's a spirit, and it's a spirit that wants to assassinate and hijack. Let me tell you what really happens. The enemy knows what has been birthed in the heavenlies, and he comes quickly, because the Bible said the prophets ran before their time.
Yes.
He runs, he sends those who run before the time, because he wants to pervert what God wants to do. And I'm telling you now, many have followed lying spirits and they have not known it. God is bringing his true prophets in this hour.
Hallelujah.
His true apostles in this hour. And we've got to break the curse on the land. Hallelujah. We've got to break the curse on the land. We've got to bring the blessing back. We've got to break the power of the enemy. And I'm talking about, really, it's on a highest level. And our authority as the church is not just on a political level, because we have to be above them. And we have to be in the heavenlies. And we must get instruction from the Father. And Elijah had an instruction. There's a time for divine confrontation. And this confrontation is to confront that spirit that is bringing a famine in the land. And this famine in the land is that people don't hear God's word anymore. People are dying. They don't even know they're dying. They got a lot of soul preachers preaching to their emotions. And they're getting all stirred up. But they go home and they feel nothing. They got a lot of educated preachers. They get all this information. But they die. They're dying. They don't even know they're dying, because they have no spirit anymore. And Elijah said, I've got to bring back healing to the nation, because there's a famine in the land. Hallelujah. There's a famine in the land. And it's a famine that has to be restored by a generation. I believe you are that generation. Glory
Amen.
To God. God's raising up that generation.
Hallelujah.
They cut off the prophets. They cut them off. They try to destroy them. They brought a problem, and they brought a condition in the land that was destroying many people's lives. And it was that God's mercy sent his prophets back. Believe God's mercy, he's sending prophets now. You know, he sends his prophets. It's not always been easy being that prophet, because people stone you, they beat you up, they accuse you falsely, they lie about you. You go through attacks, you have to war in the night. Sometimes you don't sleep because there's spirits that are trying to sign against you. And I've had it at times where I've seen people come in my room, but I've rebuked them. One person died. I didn't know that, because they astral project. You know, the enemy is trying a lot of things in this hour. But I tell you, there's a church.
Amen.
Are you my Lord Elijah? Hey, behold, Elijah's here. Behold, Elijah is here. And I'm going to say that again. Behold, Elijah is here, which is the spirit and the power of Elijah, the Holy Ghost and power.
Amen.
The Holy Ghost and power, because something I want to say, and I'm going to bring it back to the book of Genesis. Because in the book of Genesis, there was a condition, and that condition was this, that when they lost the glory, they found fig leaves. A lot of people who have lost the glory are running to the wrong thing. Fig leaves can be information, but it can also be prosperity. You check out what fig leaves mean, and it's prosperity. People think the prosperity gospel is God. God doesn't mind you blessed. But it's not about you being blessed. People are naked and they cover their nakedness with prosperity. God does not see your prosperity as his glory. People think the glory is the blessing. And I'm telling you now, God is going to begin to deal with those kind of preachers. Adam and Eve went and covered themselves with fig leaves, prosperity. God is bringing a change, hallelujah. Yeah. And what the Lord is saying is that I need to bring back people to be covered and clothed. What does the word of God say? There are many naked souls. Amen. You don't want to be a naked soul. What is a naked soul? Where you've lost the glory. You've lost the glory. And people confuse being losing the glory, and they think it's security. Amen. It's not security. It's the fire and it's the glory. And Elijah came and he said one thing. He said, I've got to deal with this false gospel and this gospel that preaches to the five senses. We live in the sense realm, but we are spiritual. And we cannot operate as God's people to begin to deal with the powers and the principalities and the rulers in this world, the demonic realm, if we're going to be caught up in the natural. We've got to be supernatural. And the clothes is what God said in the book of Acts, because he said, I want you to wait because I want to clothe you in my power. It's the power of God, which is the fire of God, which is where you become his messenger and where he anoints you in his throne room. Each one that is here this evening, God has called your inner man to go into his throne room. Glory to God. And in the throne room there is a fire, and that is where you're going to find the power, and you're going to find the clothing that you lost. Adam and Eve lost their clothing, and God does not see as we see. God, I always say, now church doesn't even see a color. God is colorblind, but God sees the spirit. God only sees your heart, and if your heart is not in the right place, and if you're naked, he does not have any naked souls in his kingdom. Hallelujah. We have to get into the fire. He said, wait in Jerusalem and get the fire. I tell you, the prayer of a righteous man, a woman of God that is filled with fire. You know, there's something. It's not about the people that are here tonight, the amount of people, because I believe Elijah was one man. God is preparing a people that are not about numerics, because you get a lot of numerics, but you sometimes lose the consistency. God is bringing a people that want consistency, and that is the Holy Ghost and power. And out of the Holy Ghost and power, we're going to birth a move of God. In fact, God is sifting through the church, and he's separating through the church. We're not here for entertainment. I'm going to tell you something, another thing about Jezebel, the dragon. Is I call the Jezebel the dragon. It's emotions. We minister to emotions and the soul. You don't need a minister to the soul. You do not need psychology. Psychology is another world. The soul is another world. The spirit is another world. God said we must live by the spirit. You don't need psychology, because if you get into psychology, it's an abyss. It's deep. It's dark. You'll never get to the bottom of what's in there, because that's the soul. That's the lower soul. God wants to bring you up into the spirit to rule.
Come on.
Amen. Amen.
Again, the dragon, what he confronted. And I say it's the spirit of Jezebel, the dragon, the beast. But what people are running for today is the dragon, which means to fascinate. The dragon means to fascinate. People want to be fascinated. They want to be entertained. And preachers want to entertain people. We're not here as entertainers. We're here to get you full of the Holy Ghost. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. They want to be fascinated. And you know, you want to show, and we want to see, you know. So I know one guy, he made it so dramatic when he cast out devils, I felt sorry for the people. You know, all Jesus did was, I mean, I went with my parents, we'd go to India, and we'd have literally the house, the line, the whole road would be just filled with people that God would just bring demons out of them. Just hours, demons. But we didn't sit and spend hours casting devils out of people. The devil must come out in Jesus' name.
Amen.
The demons must flee.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Elijah said this. He said, I want you to do something. I want you to go. I want you to go to Mount Carmel. You know, the restoration that God is going to bring is we have to clean the mountains. We have to clean the high places. And where Adam lost it was in the garden. But Carmel means a garden. But let me say this, the Baal prophets, now let me say again, now Jezebel has Baal prophets, and what Elijah said is, I'm going to visit you where you have your power. Because a lot of people have their power, the false prophets have their power in what was. God took Adam and Eve out of the garden. He never really wanted them to go back in the garden. Because he's got a higher realm. Are you here with me today? He's got a higher purpose. The Garden of Eden. Eden means pleasures. We got a pleasure gospel. People want pleasure. People want entertainment. They want to go to the garden. Praise God. Jesus was in the Garden of Gethsemane. And that's where he died. That's where he sweated blood. Oh, hallelujah. And so he went and he said, I want you to assemble all the prophets on Mount Carmel. And in Mount Carmel, there's another thing. There's a queen, the queen of heaven. Let me say this now, because the big thing today is we've got a tremendous problem in the world where they want to emasculate God. And God is not really, God is spirit. But God made Adam and Eve. In the beginning it says he made him Adam Cha, which is male and female, but he made them one. God is not as we know him. God is different attributes. But the one attribute that the devil hates so much is the masculine part of God, because it's authority. The enemy hates authority, and today we have a situation where there's a tremendous resistance, and there's a spirit, which is the queen of heaven, the mother earth. Amen. That's where Mount Carmel was, and he said, now, you divided between two places. You divided between, you're living in the spirit, you're living in the flesh, you're in carnality, and you don't know who you are. And there's a burning coming. Come on, somebody say, there's a burning coming. So something the Lord said to me is that there's a correction. God is bringing correction. But something else he said, I want to bring consecration. Consecration. God wants to bring consecration. The altars must be rebuilt in our garden. Where we are entertaining and focused on entertainment, I want to bring an adjustment, a correction. I want to bring discipline to you so that you can come into the place of consecration. Somebody say consecration. Consecration. Consecration is really, I've separated you from this world. I've separated you to myself. You are mine and I'm yours. But you have to rebuild the place of burning. You have to rebuild. Somebody say rebuild the altar. So the altars have to be established again. And that's what prayer is. Prayer is not just chakata rama mana mana manana, and even all these words. Sometimes prayer is just like what Abraham did with Isaac. He put him right there on the altar. He said, God, there's my prayer. I don't have anything else to say. I don't have anything else to do. There is my prayer. My prayer is there. Amen. My prayer is my act of faith. My prayer is my consecration. My prayer is my decision. My prayer is taking up the cross and following you. My prayer is denying myself. God will be more honored by that prayer of obedience and 40 days of fasting and 7 and 10 hours of praying. Come on, somebody. A lot of people want to pray all day and fast, but they never want to be obedient to God's word and God's will. They want to do it their own way through the flesh. They would rather fast. I've seen people fast 40 days and after 40 days commit adultery because they did it in their own strength. In fact, when you fast, sometimes you can get stronger in your own self. Because people want to manipulate God. God would rather you just do one little act of Amen. Obedience, and that's consecration. Amen. Somebody say consecration. God is calling the people to himself, separating the people to himself, calling a people to himself. That's the spirit of Elijah. It's coming, and it is the power, like John, the gift of God, the Holy Ghost, is here to prepare the way. Amen. And I'm telling you, it's not going to be about rich folk or poor folk anymore. It's not going to be about who in the zoo. It's going to be about the Holy Ghost. It's going to be about the Spirit of God. It's about the church coming together. Amen. And that's why I believe we're here with Bishop Mwaka, and praise God, Bishop Fondon, and my other bishop. Hallelujah. Ah, there's all new names for me, but hallelujah. And I know he's a mighty man of God, and I love you. And hallelujah. Amen. But God is bringing all kinds of people together, because we are going into a new season. The world, the new age, the world governments want to bring their utopia. We as the church are losing what God wants to do by his Spirit. Come on, somebody. They want to bring a whole one world and this whole system and this whole peace. But we're fighting because we're not dying. We're not dying. We're not building the altars. And the altar is real, my brothers and sisters. And if I say one thing, because Bishop Fondon said the one thing, that this is about prayer. Let me tell you something about Elijah. The Word of God said the prayer of a righteous man or woman of God, that prayer was a prayer that was a pain, that had pain. Because the Word of God said he was a man of passions like us. He was a man that had to confront every passion, and he had to build an altar. I'm here to tell you, the more of the Holy Ghost you have, the more Jesus you have, the more you're going to confront in your old nature the devil. You're going to confront those passions will not decrease, but they will increase. Oh, hallelujah. The greater authority. Now, what Elijah had was an authority over his own universe. Let me say it like this. Scientists are discovering they don't even understand how we can be together as human beings. How we can put, they say what's keeping us together, and they're trying to find out how to get it. It's called gluon. What's keeping us together, they say, is gluon. Man, it's the Word of God. But let me tell you, in this body, it's not just a body. In this body, there's all kinds of atoms, subatomic particles. For the Word of God said, if you rule your world, you will begin to rule over many worlds. Because if you can rule this world within this world, these passions, these emotions, there's a destiny far higher than you could ever imagine. And Elijah had power over principalities and powers. I'm going to say this. Many people want to go after demons, and it's true. But let me tell you, when you get angry, when you get fearful, you are birthing demons. All you have to do is say, I'm not going to get angry, I'm going to walk in love. I am going to die to those passions and emotions. I'm not going to get bitter, I'm going to get better. Devil, you're under my feet. And you know that automatically, because the demons are energies. And they feed off of you. And they grow off of your emotions. Now what Elijah had was, he never allowed the demons to feed. He never energized them. Because the spirit is not energy. The new age works through energy. Demons are orbs, energies. The Holy Ghost is dunamis power.
Amen.
He said, you shall receive dunamis power. It's dunamis, which means it just keeps growing and it keeps growing. And it's not energy. It doesn't have to be worked up. Come on, somebody. It's just you tap into it. What releases it? Sacrifice. Consecration.
Amen.
And he said, I want to build the altar. The altar is the place where what many people do, they go to the god of entertainment, idolatry, false imaginations. The Lord said to me, 2015 is the year where I'm calling my people to deal with idolatry. And I'm going to say this, the prophetic, the false prophets have been prophesying to the imaginations of people. Mm-hmm. And they've been creating these scenarios. Let me tell you, imaginations are high things that stand against God. And it's in the church. It's not in the world. There's a lot of people. The Bible said the left hand will be against the right hand. What's that? The fleshly church against the church of the spirit. The right hand. The power. The left. The right. The left. The right. Come on. What's out of the flesh? Is flesh. What's out of the spirit is spirit. God is calling a church of the spirit. What will part the waters is the mantle, the Holy Ghost. Will divide what is of the flesh, what is of the spirit. The left hand has knowledge. The left hand has a sword. The right hand is knowledge. The right hand has a sword. So you meet some believers that are on the left hand and they come with their swords. They don't understand the right hand. That's for some people out there. God said, I have to deal with Baal. Because Baal is your senses. The bull. It works it. It works it. It's the five senses. It's the golden calf. It's what people erected because they didn't want to wait on the Lord. And that's what the Baal prophets work through. They work through the bull. Amen. The bull. They work through the bull. They work through that bull. And that bull has a lot of power. And it has a lot of power in the senses. God's power is beyond that power of the bull. But he said this, and I'm going to just go very quickly, because God wants us to become those people that have authority. And before we have that authority, we've got to kill the bull. And we've got to put the bull on the altar. You've got to put your emotions on the altar, your five senses on the altar. You've got to kill the bull. Somebody say, kill the bull.
Kill the bull.
Elijah said, I'm going to call on the fire of God. But first, I'm going to let everybody do what they do. The false prophets, the Baal prophets, don't know how to deal with the old nature. Come on. He said, I want to do something. He said, I'm going to show you something. And this, I'm going to be closing now, because we have correction. We have consecration. Hallelujah. And then we have a connection. God wants to establish a connection. But before we have the connection, we have to kill the bull. That's the altar. And the bull is where you say, Lord, I'm going to take that bull. He said, take that bull. I want you to put it on the wood. You've got to put it on the cross.
Wow.
If you can put it on the cross, you've got to die to it. You're not going to prophesy through it. You're not going to move through it. You've got to die to it. He put it on the cross. You kill the bull. Put it on the wood. When he put it on the wood, he said, I want you to add water to it. I want you to fill it, because my word is my knowledge and my power. I want you to clothe it. I want you to kill it. And when you kill it, I'm going to put my water on it. Much word. Hallelujah.
Amen.
And then I'm going to show you something, and I'm going to show the world something, because this is what is going to shock many people, because that's what they did with Jesus. Jesus allowed himself to go through the humiliation. And he endured humiliation. He endured the world system and what they did to him. And through that humiliation, there was a underestimation. Let me say this. Satan just never stops. He just keeps carrying on. But God God, I always say, has the plan in the plan. So he sees beyond. He put it on the altar. He put the wood, put it on the wood, on the cross. When you put it on the cross, and you just say, Lord, I just put that word on it. I'm going to keep confessing the word. I'm going to keep declaring the word. I'm going to keep standing on the word. Elijah called because he had control. I see a lot of people praying. And I've seen a lot of people declaring. I've seen a lot of people binding and loosing. The realm to bind and loose is you have to be able to go into the realm of the Spirit. Now I'm going to say there's a danger because many people talk about portals. And I've always said this, there are no portals. Portals is like Old Testament. And if you're from Africa, you understand that because you have to go through, you've got this witch doctor that's more powerful than that witch doctor because he's got a bigger angel and he's got bigger demons. You understand? And so you've got a lot of people in the church talking about portals because some people have got angels that have got bigger connections. Well, Jesus said, I'm going to destroy that thing. Because that's the old system, the powers of principalities and the powers of the air. Come on, somebody. And God said, you don't need to go through portals. You go through the door. And it's the cross. And it's the cross that will bring the resurrection. And the cross will give you access to the fire. And it's the fire that will release the power. Come on, somebody. When you go through the cross, you establish the connection. When you kill the bull, you establish the connection. And this is the generation that I'm here to say that God is about to raise up in this hour. There's much I can say, but I want to be sensitive to Bishop and Waka. I bless you in the name of Jesus, and I look forward to tomorrow morning. God bless you. Thank you.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Can we stand up together? I want us to pray.